Hey guys, so today I'm back with my fourth video on electric charges and field. This video will deal with the concept of electric field. So let's go ahead. So basically, what do we understand by electric field and why did we feel the need for this quantity called as electric field? So to understand this, consider the situation. Suppose there is a charged body. It is carrying some positive charge. Fine. Now a very 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 small charge called as test charge is brought somewhere near this source charge. So this test charge will obviously experience some force due to this source charge. Now to understand the idea behind the interaction, we explain it in terms of electric field. So what do we say? We say that this source charge created an electric field around itself. There was an environment around itself which was electrical in nature, and we gave this electrical environment a name called as electric field. So whenever another charge would come into the space where the electric field of source charge is there, it will experience some force. And in fact, if I have to prove that there is an electric field at any given point, what do we need to do is we will simply place a small positive test charge Q naught there. We will place that small positive test charge at that particular point, and we will see if that test charge is experiencing any force. So if it is experiencing any force, it would mean that there is an electric field present in that region. Okay, so we can define electric field as that it is an electric field is said to exist at a point if a force of electrical origin is being exerted on a stationary charged body placed at that point. So if I have to attach a numerical value to it, I can consider that electric field would be the force experienced by a unit charge placed at that point. So it is force per unit charge, which is this quantity is called as electric field. So we have to consider, we have to keep one thing in mind, that this test charge which we are using to prove that yes, there is an electrical environment, this test charge needs to be very very small so that it does not alter the electrical field of the source charge in any manner. So just to ensure this, how do we write? We write it as electric field is force per unit charge in the limit of Q naught tending to zero, meaning that Q naught has to be so small that it cannot alter the electrical field of the source charge. Fine. So as you can see very easily from the expression also, this is a vector quantity. It's a vector quantity, and the units, let's discuss the units. So what would be the unit of electrical field? It is force per unit charge. So the units of force are obviously Newton, the unit of charge are Coulomb. So the unit of electrical field then become Newton per Coulomb. It is Newton per Coulomb. If I have to, I can also write it as volt per meter. I can replace it by volt per meter. Now if I have to look at the dimensions of electric field, again electric field dimensions would be dimensions of force divided by the dimensions of charge. Dimensions of force are mLT minus 2. The dimension of charge I am writing as coulomb, which can be written in terms of fundamental quantities. I can write it as ampere into time taken. So this ultimately reduces to mLT raised to power minus 3 ampere raised to power minus 1. So these are the dimensions of electric field. Now we come on to the physical significance of electrical field. This is my charge, source charge, and this is my test charge. So if I keep this test charge here, the interaction obviously would be different. The force experience would be different. If I change the test charge position to this point, the value of force experience and hence force per unit charge also would change. So basically, electric field, when we talk about it, it's not a single vector. It is a set of infinite vectors. So a set of infinite vectors is basically called as a vector field. So when we're talking about electric field, we are in fact talking about a vector field, because there is no one quantity associated with the force which is being experienced by the charge. That force is going to differ based upon the fact what is the position of the charge with respect to the source charge. Let us do a simple question on this concept so that it becomes much clearer to us. So the question here says that we have to calculate the electric field strength which is required to support a water drop of given mass and given charge. So they have given us the charge, the total charge on the water drop, and they have given us the mass on the water drop. Now what they are asking is how much electric field strength is required to support this water drop. Now to solve this question, first of all we need to know what is the force on water drop due to the electric field. So force on water drop due to electric field, it would be equal to obviously the weight. It should balance out the weight of the drop. Only then the water drop would be in equilibrium. So the force on water drop due to electric field should balance out the weight of the drop. So force on water drop would be equal to the Q into E. We just did the formula that electric field is force divided by Q. So the force vector becomes Q into E. So this should be balanced by the weight of, this should be balancing the weight of the water drop. So this gives us the value of electric field as mg by Q. We can put the value of mass. Mass is 10 to power minus 3 kg. We can put the value of g as 9.8. Charge is given as 1.6 into 10 to power minus 19. Solving this will give me the required value of electric field. Now let's see what would be the expression for electric field due to a point charge. In fact, we have already we did that expression. So let's do it formally. So consider this source charge and this is my test charge. There is a distance of R between them. So here is my source charge somewhere at point O. This source charge, let it be Q. Somewhere here at point P is my test charge Q naught. Now test charge is always going to be a positive charge by convention. So this is my test charge, and if the source charge I am taking to be positive, test charge would experience a repulsive force towards the right hand side. So this force would be equal to as per Coulomb's law, it would be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1, which is my source charge Q, Q2, which is my test charge Q0, divided by the distance between them R square along the line joining the two charges. So R hat. Now, if I want to get the value of electric field associated with this point charge, it would be F divided by Q0. So we divide this above expression by Q0, that would give me 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R square along R hat direction. Okay, so this has given us the electric field vector E. Now we can easily see that electric field vector is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the charges. So it basically means, if we talk about a spherical region around the point charge, if I talk about point charge as being here and I consider a spherical region around the point charge, that along a spherical surface the electric field would be same. It won't depend upon the direction of R, it would just depend upon the distance from the source charge. So this type of a field is called as a spherically symmetric field. So for a point charge, the electric field associated would be spherically symmetric in nature. Okay. Next we come to electric field due to a system of charges. So obviously it very rarely we would find an isolated charge and we would be asked to find out the its effect on a test charge. So generally we consider there is a system of charges. So here we can see a system of charges. We have charges Q1 and Q2, which are at a distance of R1P and R2P from a point P where we have kept our test charge. So at this point P we have kept our test charge. So we want to see what is the electrical field associated due to a system of charges when there is more than one charge. So to have a look at this, let's consider what would be the force experienced by test charge Q0 due to charge kept at distance R1 from the origin. So F1 would be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q0 R1P square into R1P hat. So as you can see from the diagram, what it would be a repulsive force. So E1 is going towards the right hand side direction. Similarly, we can see F2. F2 would be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Now this would be Q2, Q0, R2P whole square, and this would be along the unit vector R2P hat. Now we will use the principle of superposition of electric fields. So the electric field at any point due to a group of charges would be equal to the vector sum of electric fields which are produced by each charge individually at that point. So we will consider first, when I have to find out the electric field due to charge Q1, I can consider that charge Q2 is not there because it is not going to affect the electrical field of charge Q1. So using this principle, we can find out the total electric field due to both the charges as the vector sum. So the total electrical field would be the vector sum of electric field due to all the charges. So right now we had taken only two charges. It could be a system of n charges. So we can generalize this expression to vector E as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught summation Q1 Qi Rip hat and Rip square, where I goes from 1 to n. So to find out E1, basically what we will do, we will to find E1, I can do F1 by Q0. To find E2, I can do F2 by Q0. So this Q0 and Q0 will go away. So for E1, in expression for E1, I would just be left with R1, Q1. So that's why the term Qi here, because in E2 I am just left with the term Q2. So similarly, if we extend it to a general term, only the particle for which we are trying to find out the electric field, only that Q term will survive. And in the denominator, if we see, it is R1P whole square. So whichever particle is there, the position vector of that particle, so Rip square along vector Rip hat, that gives me the total electric field due to all the test charges. Fine. So basically it is nothing but principle of superposition. We are just taking a vector sum of all the electrical fields. So now consider this question to make the concept clearer. The question says 2 point charges of 4 microcoulomb and 1 microcoulomb are separated by a distance of 2 meter in air. We have to find the point on the line joining charges at which the net electric field of the system is going to be zero. Now when these type of questions come, see, we have to consider in which direction the electric field is going to act, because we know that electric field is a vector quantity. So we have to keep that in mind. So let's consider any 2 points A and B. Here we place a charge of Q1, which is 4 microcoulomb. 1 microcoulomb would be equal to 10 raised to the power minus 6 coulomb. Micro stand for 10 raised to the power minus 6. So Q2 charge is 1 microcoulomb. They are separated by a distance of 2 meter. You have to find a point on the line joining these charges at which the net electric field of the system is zero. So suppose if I consider any point P between them, and here I keep a test charge. So here I keep a test charge. So Q1 will repel the test charge towards B, and Q2 will repel the test charge toward A. Fine. So both the forces, if I keep a test charge at point P, both the forces which are acting at point P due to charges at A and B are going to be opposite to each other. So we can say electric field vector due to 1 should balance out the electric field vector due to charge 2. So now I simply need to put 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. This should be Q1 by, let's say this distance is x, so this distance becomes 2 minus x. So Q1 by x square should be balanced at, should be balanced by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q2, which is 1 microcoulomb, divided by 2 minus x whole square. So if we solve this expression, 1 by 4 pi epsilon and obviously cancel out, I am left with Q1 by x square equals to Q2 by a square plus b square minus 2ab. So if we solve this, we can see that there is a quadratic equation here. Okay, so there is a quadratic equation, so it will have two solutions. Fine. So the solution to this equations would be 4 by 3 meter and 4 meter. Now in this expression, we can, if we look at x equal to 4 meter, So this is 2 meter. So at a distance of x equal to 4 meter, say it would be somewhere here. Because x is coming out to be 4 meter, so it would be the point P comes out to be somewhere here. If I take the solution as x equal to 4 meter, so at point P, A is going to repel and B is also going to repel. So we can see both the forces are acting in the same direction. So we cannot accept this as the solution. The point P needs to be somewhere in the middle of the two charges, because on either side, if we see, the forces come out to be in the same direction. So we have to take this solution out of the picture. So the only solution that is available to us now is at x equals to 4 by 3 meter, meaning if I keep the test charge, or if we look at point P, which is at a distance of 4 by 3 meter from end A, then the electric field due to the two charges will balance each other out. And in such questions, you will find that answer. So this x equal to 1 by 3 meter would come out to be 1.3 meter. So we will find that x would always be at a larger distance from the bigger charge. It would be always at a slightly larger distance from the bigger charge, which if you think logically is also correct. Electric field due to a higher charge, if it needs to be balanced by a lower charge, the point needs to be closer to the lower charge so as to balance out an electric field due to a higher charge. Now this is a similar kind of question, but now the charges are opposite in nature. So let's have a look right here. When we did the question, both the charges were of equal, they were of same sign. Both the charges were positive charges. So even if both the charges are negative charges, the solution, the way we solve remains the same. But there is a slight change which we will discuss. What happens when the charges are opposite in nature? Because we know that electric field is a vector quantity. So the direction in which the electric field is there is going to change depending upon the sign of the charges involved. So here we have 16 microcoulomb charge, and at point B we have -9 microcoulomb charge. They are placed 8 centimeter apart. So please, first step ought to be that we see, let's say again they are asking, determine the position of the point at which the resultant field is zero. So resultant field, let's say it is zero at a point P, so at a distance x from end A. So this distance would be 8 minus x. Now in this case, if we look, if we keep a positive test charge here, then plus 16 microcoulomb is going to repel that charge, and minus 9 microcoulomb is going to attract that charge. Fine. So these charges, if we keep the charge somewhere in middle, the charge would the net electric field would be in the same direction. Okay, the net electric field will be in the same direction. So now what we need to do is, whenever we are coming to our answer, we should accept an answer which is, the point should not be in the middle of the two charges. Because if the point is in the middle, we can easily see that in the middle both the charges will give you force which is acting in the same direction. But consider this point Q, which is to the right of point B. So here charge B here charge P is going to attract, charge A is going to repel. So we can see both the charges, both the forces would be in opposite direction. So this point would be acceptable. Fine. So again we take the field vector, the due to total net field due to both the vectors have to be zero. So we take 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 by x square, then 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q2 by 8 minus x whole square. Now this is 8 it is given 8 centimeter. So we can convert these into meter by multiplying by 10 raised to power minus 2. But both are in denominator and both are being equated to 0. So anyways, when they go to the other side, they will just cancel out. That won't make a difference. So I'm not converting right now. Otherwise, I ought to have converted centimeter to meter. Now, Q2, when we put the sign of Q2. So Q1 I will put as 16 into 10 to the power minus 6 coulomb. Q2 I will put as minus 9 into 10 to the power minus 6. Now here the sign becomes very important. Here the sign becomes very important. If you don't put the sign, it would give you an incorrect answer. Okay, it would give you an incorrect answer. So either you can write E1 if we are not considering the sign. If we don't want to consider the sign, then I can simply write E1 equals to E2. But then we ignore the sign. Otherwise, if we are keeping our sign into consideration, then I will write E1 plus E2 should be equal to 0. And then I put the sign. So whatever method you employ, please make it a point to write it very clearly down. That what are you, which method you are employing, which technique you are employing. So once we put the values, these will give me the values of x as 32 centimeter and 32 by 7 centimeter. So if we consider 32 by 7 centimeter, that would be somewhere less than between the two charges. So we cannot consider this as our answer between the charges, because we know that if we, for two opposite charges, if we consider a region between them, then the forces due to two opposite charges will be in the same direction. So we have to ignore this solution, and the only solution then left is 32 centimeter, which is towards the right of charge B. That is an acceptable solution to the problem asked. So that's it for today. So I've tried to take different type of numericals to different and important type of numericals. So I hope this would help, and I'll see you in next class. Thank you.